Thanks for that very warm welcome, Sarah. And I think that's typical of your profession. You don't read the profile, you relate to people personally. And I'll tell my wife all that because she's been trying to get me to clean out the garage for several years now. And I can tell her I have important work to do on that computer. People are saving my stuff. And thanks for coming to these things. I mean, just people continuing to try to grow and learn to be the best they can be. Isn't that what we're trying to do with our students? Encourage them to be lifelong learners. I just still get excited at my advanced age to see people stepping aside, creating time to network with each other, to continue to grow. The only thing I miss at these things is I wish there were some students here seeing the modeling. Ability to try to help them. I'd love to get their insights. Maybe some of that will emerge today, but thank you for being here. And thanks for inviting me. This is the second time I've addressed developmental educators. I did one last year in Kentucky. It was a lot of fun. And I'd have to say, my wife asked me after reminding me I still needed to clean out the garage, asked me about this trip. How do you feel about it? And I said, I feel real good about it because it's the audience. Developmental educators, learning assistance professionals, first-year experienced people, and academic advisors are my favorite people to work with. Their heart and mind is in the right place. They are student-centered, holistic, and focused. You know, my background, I'll confess to my background a bit. I'm a psychology guy. I used to go to American Psychological Association. I used to go to the American Educational Research Association. And I began to realize, I don't know if this was about undergraduate students or about professional egos. When I go to conferences like this, it seems like people check their egos at the door and students come first. So I am happy to be here. I know that's the socially appropriate and political sensitive thing. It's like a rock star, you're the best audience I've ever played to. But I mean that sincerely. And this is the first time I'm embarrassed to say this. I'm from the New York metropolitan area. This is the first time I have ever been in this part of the country. And we are so lococentric in New York. You know how we are. We're so provincial. It's like anything north of the Bronx is upstate. Then there's New England, Nova Scotia, Scandinavia, I don't know, Antarctica, whatever, you know. And I'm just coming back here because I grew up and now I'm on the left coast. Don't get me started about that experience, but to see the leaves again just brought back a lot. The beauty, I don't know if you, sometimes we take it for granted when we're in a place for a while. In fact, I almost got lost here because 91 next and there were orange and yellow leaves growing over the, I didn't know if it was left, right, straight, and luckily I made the right choice and I'm here on time. This picture here, the colors just brought back a lot. I actually tried to dress for the colors. Looking for any excuse not to wear a suit. I'm sorry, that just throws my game off, assuming for a moment that I have game. But just a quick note about me, because I know people respond to the messenger as much as the message. I am not a developmental educator per se. My background is in psychology, learning, memory. I have advised developmental students. I'm an advocate for developmental students. My first thing, I'm not bragging, I just want to show you the thing. But one of the things I'm most proud of is that I was advising developmental students. You know, they have limited access to certain college courses because they don't have the prereq. And two of those courses were courses that I taught, general psychology and developmental psychology. And when I moved to California, I noticed there was this requisite, college writing was required. And I asked the dean, because I was advising students who wanted to take my courses, and asked, did we ever do any research? Could they? I think these students seem very motivated and disciplined. I think they could succeed in my course. So we did one of those blind control things where they just let some of those students in my courses the next semester. And they did as well as students who had the prerequisite. I'm not saying prerequisites aren't important, but sometimes I think we estimate the motivation, the drive of developmental students. And to this day, we don't have that prerequisite anymore. My whole thing is teaching, advising, and committee work. That's all I've done my whole life. Everything I'm sharing with you today is grown organically from working with students like you work with. I've never taught developmental math or English, but I've taught developmental students, so I advise them. Many of the strategies and ideas have grown. I am not a researcher. People getting me confused with Vincent Tinto. which Regina mentioned. He's another diminutive Italian guy from Queens. We're from the same neighborhood. We have same ethnic background, same size, but I have a much higher vertical leap. I'm convinced of that. Everything I'll share with you really grew organically out of the work you do, including this little outline. I think the conference organizers have done a great job of keeping costs down, and I'm sorry I elevated the course by having to kill some trees. But this was something that actually, you have that outline that's bordered, developmental edge. I was teaching, my first teaching job was at Kirkwood Community College in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Incidentally, the students there referred to the place as Jerkwood. I want to come back to that. I'll never forget that in 1975. It was my first illumination into something that I think affects us all. And they weren't taking notes in my human relations class. And I was writing notes on the, this was before PowerPoint and smart rooms. I'm writing all the my detailed out, definitions on the board, and they weren't taking notes. And then when I lost eye contact with them, there was more classroom discipline problems. So I was desperate. A new faculty member, just with my master's teaching part-time while I was finishing up the doctorate. So I thought, well, maybe if I created an outline with the stuff that I was writing on the board in print, all the technical definitions, and just leave spaces, maybe they would get the hint that something should go in those spaces. And, you know, it worked. They took better notes, their grades started to improve, and I thought I had, as a new faculty member, came up with this great pedagogical idea. I was actually going to send it to the Teaching of Psychology Journal, only to find out when I was doing the research review, the British call this skeletal outline or program notes. It was around many years, and that was my first clue that I better do some reading. We talk about students being underprepared for college. Most PhD faculty members are underprepared for college. You know, I learned nothing about teaching in 6.5 years, nothing on advising, nothing how to construct a valid and reliable classroom test, or how frequently I should assess, or the nature of the feedback. I had to learn that trial and error. That's why I'm here. It's just running scared for those first 5 years, just starting to read, trying to figure. I thought I had the terminal degree. I was at the top of the food chain. You know, I'm ready to go. And then it was just running scared, trying to learn, trying to piece it together. And the result is really many of the things I'm going to share with you today. So if I could bring you to that, notice the spaces are not that large, which shows you that there's not a lot of profound things that I'm going to say today. And this is supposed to be a keynote. I always wonder, what's that keynote mean? Does that mean you take notes on some key points? I don't know. Anyway, so I thought that would tie in here. If you see page 2 there, or it's technically page 1, but it's labeled 2 after the cover page. It's called the big picture. I want to take a shot at the context. Look at the forest before the trees. There are little assumptions that I think underlie people's reaction to our work. And you know, we don't work in isolation. We work in a system. You know, our work can be sabotaged by people around us or supported by people around us. And that's my point here. I want to take a look at the big picture, then we'll drill deeper and look at the student situation and strategies. But we do operate in a system that I want to make sure we're armed and ready to defend what we do, is the backdrop of this. This model, you may be familiar with Alexander Aston's work at UCLA. I really admire him. He and Ernest Boyer have really been my idols as I was learning how to teach and learning how to be a professor, I guess. And he calls this the talent development. You may refer to as value-added learning. It's a simple model, but I thought it would give us the backdrop, the forest, before we jump into the trees. Students come to us, that's input stage, right? At college entry. Not all students come to us at the same starting line, right? That's our business. Students can come in with varying levels of academic preparedness, typically defined as basic skills, family income, and prior college experience. All those three, put those together, are major risk factors. If you know the research, the more developmental ed they take, the higher the risk they don't complete. Family income, low income is a predictor of attrition. Families' prior experience, if they're first generation college students, even if they're academically prepared, I'm finding research, they lack the college knowledge, you know, even though they have the skills. That's why I'm so happy that the first year experience people are here today. I think we need that partnership with not only the skill building, but that strategic learning and how to navigate college. David Connolly at Oregon calls it college knowledge. Academic advising then really becomes critical because they don't have anyone at home giving them the tips on how to navigate college. They depend on us for that. They don't have parents, brothers, sisters, or friends in the hood, in the neighborhood who are going to be doing that. Now we need to consider that, and who is better at assessing this? That's the beauty of what we do. We are assessing at the input stage. Hold that thought. Good assessment is not just outcomes assessment. We need a baseline to make meaningful sense of assessment results. Then comes the environment. That's what we do. I don't want to butcher the English language because I know there are a lot of English professionals here. Some people call this throughput. What we do, that's what the focus is on the rest of this talk and probably the rest of the day. Your colleagues talking about what we do in the trenches, roll up the sleeves day to day. That's what we can control. And then the result is the output. What are their characteristics at graduation? That's the product. Using business metaphor, the product, are students products? Students are not just customers, aren't they our products as well? Products, and they're not just customers. And it's not just the bottom line. I hear this a lot with this business. This is why I'm here. I retired, I resigned. We had this business-oriented press, everything was the bottom line. But the bottom line does not make sense unless you look at the starting line, if you know what I mean. We can't, last night I mentioned at dinner after too much wine, that students at very selective institutions who come in with so much social capital and economic capital, I'll pick the Harvard of the West Coast, Stanford. Of course, they say Harvard is the Stanford of the, you know, it's such ridiculous nonsense. But you could take their students and put them in deep freeze for 4 years and thaw them out. They're going to still do very well on outcomes assessment. This is not a slam at Stanford or Harvard if you have friends or family or if you're a graduate. But it's what we add above and beyond what they bring to the table that matters most. What is learning anyway? Well, we struggle with outcomes. Have you tried outcomes assessment? We're obsessed about that. But what is learning? It's learning out. To me, learning by definition is change, a gain. By definition, how far have we taken them? What is development? It's change from point A to point B. My point here is that the work we do with underprepared students positions us to have the most impact. You know what I'm getting at? The most gain. Yes, it's a challenge, but to the extent that we bring them far from where they were to where they are when they leave, I know we don't have 100% success. That's maximum change. And my point, that should be the definition of a quality college or a quality professional. But that's not how we do it in America, unfortunately. We define quality at input, selectivity. You know how it is. You heard, that's a great college. No one's ever stepped foot on the place. How do they know? If it's hard to get into, it must be a great place. Selectivity and quality get mixed up here, and that hurts us. That's why community colleges will never be ranked in U.S. News and World Report, as long as we're not competitive. My point is, it's not the students who we let in, it's the type of students we turn out relative to the way they were when they came in that defines a quality college and a quality profession. And we, admitted challenges, we have the opportunity to produce the most gains, and I know it happens. This is what gets us into these issues like, should we go for equity or quality? You've heard this, equity or quality? Access or excellence? Why is this dichotomy here? It's because we define quality on who we let in. It should be defined on how they've turned out relative to the way when they came in. Where are the Greenfield folks? People from Greenfield are hosting. I like the way you describe excellence. Excellence and access. Excellence and that was your website. You put them together like it's not a zero-sum game. You can have access and excellence simultaneously. I got to give the Greenfield people some strokes because they are hosting us, and I thought that was a cool thing. But seriously, we define quality in American higher education almost in the admissions process when it should be defined in the educational process. And that's what the rest of the day is, identifying high-impact practices that really promote gain or change. Now, why am I telling you all this? I was really tempted to. I don't think we get the respect we deserve. Did we go into this business to make big bucks? If we did, didn't we make a big mistake? I thought we went into this business to make a big difference. When you go to bed at night and thinking that you had an impact on a student who, without your help, that student would have not made it. That, to me, is a quality education. It's transformative. You heard that term. Transformative education is what we're about. And I'm telling you this because, you know, the argument for what we do is stronger than any other time in the history of American higher education. You know, our demographics are changing. If we don't start succeeding with the type of students that we've historically served, it's not only serving those students, it's serving the country. We are going to be in trouble. You know, we're dropping in completion rates. You know the data. We're down 14 now and slipping quickly. What we do now is really what education was intended to do, the great equalizer, the opportunity for those who haven't had access to the American dream to get a piece of that dream. And isn't it cross-generation? I'm getting so old now that I'm having students of students, you know, I'm embarrassed to say this, and I'm seeing the cross-generational effect of what we do. We get one to succeed, then their children succeed. I know their grandchildren succeed. This is powerful stuff that you do. I'm telling you all this because it's my experience with developmental educators, first-year experience professionals, advisors. You're not only student advocates, student-centered advocates. You not only advocate, but you are agitators, too. You are the change agents at your institution. And I'm saying this to you just to give you some ammunition to remind people what we're about. Selectivity is killing us. It's defining quality in terms of who we let in. We define quality in the type of students we turn out and what we've done to make that difference. And I think we need to be armed and ready to make that case. Thanks for your patience with me on that. That was sort of the that was the inspiration part. Now we get to the perspiration, right? Let's turn to the E, in the environment model. And that will constitute the rest of this. And I want to make sure my first goal is to get you to transition to all those great breakout sessions, which I'm looking forward to attending myself, except the one that I have to lead after this. After that, I'm coming to yours. My takeaway there, advocate and agitate. I don't want you to get fired, but I want you to light a fire and be ready to argue. You know, I'm serious about developmental ed. It costs so much. It costs so much. It's costing us. You look at the percentage of the higher ed budget that goes to developmental education, it's minuscule. It's less than 2%. We're not only effective, we're cost effective, and we're cost effective across generations. We're not only doing educationally effective things, we're doing the patriotic thing. I feel that our nation depends on the kind of work that we do. I'm sorry, I beat that to a pulp and I threw in three things that I didn't even mean to. I get too emotional. Let's turn to the environment. You know, I was making the point about difference making. George Kuh, which I think Regina referred to in introductory remarks, started this project in the late 90s. He identified students who had unusually high graduation rates relative to the type of students they admitted. That's different than just saying you have a high retention rate. Well, that's great. If you're super selective, that doesn't mean anything. You've solved the problem at the admission stage, not in the environmental stage. And don't you think some colleges are not trying to do that nationally? That's their solution to the completion problem. Get more selective rather than focus on the E. Okay. Well, Kuh was looking at schools who had higher than predicted graduation rates based on the number of at-risk students they took in, typically low income. Your commuter campuses, you know, that's a risk factor too. If they're commuting rather than residential, first generation, and developmental needs. And they were looking at what you would call, remember that book Outliers by Malcolm? Gladwell, New York Times guy. He was looking at the outliers. It was a nice, so we started out quantitatively using multiple regression, plugging in all these student characteristics. What about these institutions who seem to be doing a good job of graduating students with quality? And he found that these were three core characteristics of these institutions. a pervasive attitude that all students can succeed. Now, I know that seems obvious, but that's not true in higher ed. I have faculty members who believe their job is to produce that bell-shaped curve. They are the gatekeepers, not gateway, gatekeepers. That attitude is pervasive in institutions that have had higher than predicted success rates. Number two, a sense of inclusiveness characterized this family. I don't want to be accused of warm fuzzies, which I've been accused of, or touchy-feely, but it matters that they feel they're part of a community and that people, they belong. That's Tinto's whole idea of sociology of retention. He's a sociologist, feeling that this is a place that cares about them, they're part of this family. Now, we're going to try to operationalize that in the next section. A strongly held sense of mission that recognizes the campus as distinctive or special. This is something I would encourage you when you go back. I'm disheartened those students at Kirkwood who called it Jerkwood, because they felt they were at an institution that anyone could get into, therefore they were at a loser institution. We need to be more, I think, intentional about pride and what makes our campus distinctive, what makes our mission, and that includes community college. You know, community college is an American invention. I was telling at dinner last night after that glass of wine that I have had the opportunity, only because of the internet, people find me on the internet, to go to some other countries, and they are very curious about our community colleges because they're facing the same demographic challenges we are. More underprepared, first generation, students of color. They can't afford to be as elitist as they have been. You know how it is, you don't cut it, you go vocational technical, you're out of the higher ed or post-secondary or tertiary system. They are very curious about our access system. The community college is the American dream personified. It's democracy's college. And I would argue, even those working at four-year institutions, we need to be proud of the difference-making we're making. That's what distinguishes us. And articulate what makes our mission, our place special. And I wish I had more time to go into that. Maybe that's one of the things for the conversation later. But especially if we're not on U.S. News and World Report. They've got it. Harvard doesn't, they could do nothing and still have great reputation. We have to, if we're not intentional, it reverts to the default ranking system unless we intentionally articulate what makes Greenfield a great college, what makes a community college a great place to be. Anyway, these are the characteristics generally of institutions that make a difference. Now, the first two I think we're going to talk about today. The third one, that's why I took a little time, I think. In fact, if I can brag a little bit, it's not bragging if it's strength recognition, right? Our first year experience course at our college was the only course on campus where the mission of the college appeared on the syllabus. You know, because the purpose of the course tied in so directly to what our college was intending to do. I'm going to places where they can't articulate what the mission is or the vision. Koo found that those institutions who were successful, there was a consensual idea when they went across campus. See, they started out with the statistics and they did the campus visits. By the way, I slipped there. It was a nice quantitative, qualitative study. So used multiple regression to identify the outliers. Then Koo's an anthropologist. Go to campus, talk to the students, talk to the faculty, talk to the support professionals. And one thing that emerged, that they had an understanding of what this place was about and what made it special. In fact, I was trying to wear the colors for Greenfield. I couldn't find it on the web. Is it green and white? I should have done it. I was going to guess and ended up going with the fall thing, because the ultimate motive was to avoid the suit anyway. And is there a mascot for Greenfield Community College? I don't mean to be silly. Can we simulate or approximate the rah-rah? The other thing about the international places, they can't get over the school pride stuff we have in the States. March Madness and bonfires, and that's foreign to them. But they're interested in it because they know that institutional pride promotes persistence, and they're trying to see if they can simulate that. Foundational principles of student learning and success. Are we ready to dig into the environment a little bit more deeply now? And I'll see if I can do this expeditiously and give you time to transition. What I've been trying to do here, and let me see if I can summarize it in the next slide, this is something that's kind of emerged over about a quarter of a century, where I was trying to figure out what really makes a difference. And, you know, we were criticized in educational research of keep coming up with new stuff that's just a repeat of what's done before, like the new math, here we go again. But I find these seven things recurrent over years and years of research, and the repetition suggested to me that they were themes, that they were high power themes that we might be able to use. They're all student-centered. This is what should happen in students that would produce success, defined as retention, completion, academic achievement, higher level thinking. That could go across the curriculum. If I would redo that slide, I was trying to include the two-year and four-year, we could shift the horizontal axis to say advising, teaching, learning support, you know what I mean? It could cut across campus services as well. I'm looking for a common language of student success that we could all use, whether in first-year experience, academic advising, library science. I do believe there is a subtle common language. And all of this is research-based, by the way. You'll see the references there. I didn't put the reference section because I wanted to save some paper, but you have my email on the front. Remember, I'm looking for an excuse not to clean out the garage. So if you want those references, let me know. I'd be happy to send them to you. Again, my motive here is we do stuff that's based on good research. People underestimate first-year experience. It's not activities to help them transition. Isn't that cute? No. What we do is built on a foundation of high-powered research principles. So part of my reason for saying this is, again, it's the armed and ready thing. We are the difference makers, which defines quality. And our work is grounded in solid, research-based, scholarly, and theoretical principles of student success. So bear with the academic definitions. We're going to pull out of that the practical implications. But the logic is, let's back up what we can do if possible with research, and maybe we can get a little bit more respect and support for what we do. Personal validation is the first one on there. Success is fostered when students feel personally significant, when they feel recognized as individuals, that they matter to the institution, that the institution cares about them as whole persons. That's sort of an operational definition. The guy that people mistake me for, Vince Tinto, is much more accomplished. He's at Syracuse. He put it this way. Students are more likely to become committed to the institution and therefore stay when they come to understand that the institution is committed to them. There is no ready programmatic substitute for this sort of commitment. Programs cannot replace the absence of high-quality, caring, and concerned faculty and staff. Now, we're going to define that a little bit in detail. And the other point, it's holistic support. It's not just caring about them academically. It's caring about, you know, our students. They have issues. Time management, money management, legal problems. Their academic support is critical, but we need to support them holistically. And that is the definition. As I looked up Hunter Boylan's, one of the original definitions of developmental ed, integration of academic courses and support services. It's total person education. And that's what I see represented in the people here. Student-centered, total human being. Quick point here. Some recent research. Norton Grubb, I forgot the name of the book, I'm embarrassed to say, just came out last year. Does the name ring a bell with anyone? He's very big in developmental ed research. I like this. It was a 3-year study of 20 community colleges in depth. So they went to the people in the trenches, to the instructors, to the students, the support professionals, to try to identify factors that are working and need to be improved. And one of their findings was, student services need to be better connected to developmental ed classes. I know we're talking about collaboration, but the hip term now you're probably familiar with is course integrated support. I think supplemental instruction was one of the first examples of that, right? Bring those peers to the class rather than waiting and salivating and hoping that the students come. Then there's a lady in Michigan who's coined a term, structured learning assistance, where it's not even optional whether they go to the supplemental peer-led class outside of the, you know how supplemental instruction works. I don't want to bore you, but a peer who has taken the course and done well is in the class, and then they have this supplemental meeting, tutoring. Well, she found that the students who were not going to the supplemental, you know how it is, students underutilize resources. And those who need it the most are the ones who are most likely to blow it off. So she developed what is called structured learning assistance, where they are required based on their early grades in the class. If they are not performing at C or above level, they are required to attend those supplemental peer-led supplemental sessions. And of course, again, integrating it into the classroom. And if the first-year experienced people, first-year student success courses, that's what we do. We're constantly having resource people brought in, or we bring students to the learning center or to connect with the library. It's not a course. It's really a, can I do the Boston Hub thing? You know, I love that Boston Bruin uniform with all the spokes going out. That's what we're talking about here, where the course is a hub that connects students to all that holistic support that exists on campus that otherwise, typically, they don't take advantage of. The other thing I want to mention about caring, I know this seems hokey, but if caring, I think, taking Tinto's term, it's nice to be caring. How do we operationally define caring? If I had to, in the short time I have with you, let's learn our students' names. It matters to them whether they are 18 or 28 or 38. It's a simple thing that shows them that they are an individual. And let's learn something about them. Did you see the movie The King's Speech? Now, I know that wasn't development, that was a disability. He was a stutterer. But why did that guy who had the least qualifications, why was he successful? I'm looking at that movie with my wife and thinking, this guy built a relationship with the king. He was interested in him as a human being. That was the takeaway message for me from that movie. And that, I think, is the same principle that applies to any student in need. If we validate them, make them feel important, learn something about them, their dreams, their goals, their life. Then we can demand, we can be rigorous. To me, rigorous is built on relationships. This is not just, Joe, you're trying to be friends with your students, which I've been accused of. That's not it. You know, you heard of tough love? I believe in love tough. I love them, then I can get tough. Sharon, I don't think you gave me your best, sorry, Sharon, we met. I'm not picking her at random. And you know, I can get away with stuff because they know that I care about. They won't care how much you know until they know how much you care. I still haven't found the author of that yet. But I think that's an aphorism that is true. Once you've built the relationship, they get less defensive. I've had less academic integrity violations. I've had better attendance, even if they say, oh, Dr. Joe, I was a little guilty because I know you would be upset if I didn't come. I'll take it. I was raised Catholic. Guilt, I'll take it if that gets in the class. But no, building relationships actually builds rigor. So don't feel that this is just soft, touchy-feely stuff. It's a tool to challenge them more, which brings me to my next point, self-efficacy on your outline. You've heard of this term. It's predicting college success better than ACT, SAT, and standardized cognitive instruments. It's this basically the opposite of learned helplessness. The idea, it's based on attribution theory and motivation, that success, at least in part, is internal. It's within internal locus of control, as opposed to a student says, the teacher doesn't like me, or math is too hard. No, the argument is, well, no, I can influence my math grade by effort. And the effort can be variable. I don't know if you've heard of Carol Dweck. She talks about fixed mindset or growth mindset. This is a growth mindset. It's not fixed, like I ain't got it. I might as well forget it because I ain't going to get it. I can't do math, and I'll never be able to do math. That's fixed. And in America, we've got to be careful because, you know, we're test crazy here. And the IQ has always kind of been a measure of whether you got it or you're not. And other countries that have less, for example, Asian countries, less of that testing history and this notion that success is an ability like we have as opposed to a matter of effort, you see them working longer at problems. There's been some research on that. So we in developmental ed and first year experience and support services have to be conscious of reminding students to reflect on their effort, that effort matters. Hunter Boylan, two characteristics he's found. He was the Appalachian State guy, right? Who big leader in your field. I'm just learning about him over the last few years. I was at one conference we were together. A nice man. I thought he was a good guy. Developmental students, one key reasons why they don't succeed. External locus of control, low self-esteem. We try and kind of pick together the first two that we've been doing. Personal validation and self-efficacy. Here's Bandura, who really started it. He's at Stanford. People regulate their level and distribution of effort in accordance with the effects they expect their actions to have. That was one of the classic definitions of self-efficacy. I'm going to come back to him in a second. How do we build this? You know, it's this Nevitt Sanford, this balance of challenge and support. You've heard of that. We got to hit that moderate challenge where the student is not intimidated but not bored either. And if you hit that moderate challenge, then you get growth in the middle. You know, I think of all the work that we do in developmental ed about placement testing, trying to get at this, right? We don't want them to be bored. We don't want them to be over their head. And I know placement testing is under the gun now. We might need to do more modularizing, finding out what specific skills rather than throwing them in a course and having repeat skills that they already learned but they just forgot because they haven't practiced in a while. In fact, I'd be developmental math right now if I took an algebra test. And I was good in algebra. I was a good algebra, not geometry. I'll tell you, I lost oxygen during delivery. It's my mother's support. Did I tell you I have an external locus of control? But I would be developmental now. So the argument is, let's test them. Give them a chance to read. I don't know how it is on the East Coast, but on the left coast, senior year is a blow-off year. You know, they cruise senior year, and sometimes they go into the placement test, and they haven't done math in so long. There's a movement now, just intentional instructions to have them prep for the test or give them an opportunity to get the results and prep again and retake. But the idea of hitting that moderate point where we're truly challenging them is a classic case of developmental ed. I know we're struggling with it, but who else does that? Who attempts to try to place people as carefully as developmental education? I give you the example of that prerequisite course that I was teaching. Remember I told you before, we needed English comp to take my developmental and general psych. We never had any research on that. It was just the prior instructor that inherited it. It was just a fiat decision he had made. This notion of challenge and support, I think, is consistent with your struggle with finding accurate placement testing and getting them in a class that just stretches them. It's what makes a good video game, too, right? A video game that's boring, they'll throw it away. A video game that's too frustrating, they'll kick it away. I'm just trying to think of a metaphor. This is obviously not working. But a video game where there's that little stretch is really what we're trying to do in our field. And I think more so than anyone, developmental education has taken this principle seriously. If you want some models of how schools are now trying to do more diagnostic testing and finding the specific skills they need stretching on rather than just throw them in a course and have them repeat the whole thing, it's University of Maryland, Baltimore County, and the Community College of Baltimore County. Also, the Virginia Community College System has been doing some interesting work. If you want a website that I find a lot of great free stuff, it's out of Columbia University in New York. It's the Community College Research Center, CCRC. Tremendous synthesis and application. Much of the prep that I was doing for this came from well-done articles and syntheses that I was able to pull from that website. The other thing I wanted to point out about self-efficacy, Bandura, his original work was with children who had phobias. And one of the most powerful findings he reported is that if a child had like zoophobia, fear of dogs, and I was, maybe William was 11 and I was 10 and I could see William petting a dog that otherwise I'd be afraid of, if I saw someone like myself who I can identify with, my willingness to approach that thing I was fearful of would increase. The power of peers to increase self-efficacy. This came up at dinner last night. I think we need to do a better job of tracking our alums who've been successful. Bring them back. Show them that students like themselves, same color, same socioeconomic background, same ethnicity, have made it. It's my experience with alums, they love to come back and tell their story. And it's cost effective. We're always after their money. I want their inspiration and their motivation. Peers can be a powerful source of improving self-efficacy in our current students. Seeing students like themselves who've done it based on peers. I'm happy to see, I was looking over the program this morning, sessions on student leaders and peer mentors. And of course, you know, and people in learning assistants have been using peer tutors for years. I remember teaching ed psych and cross-age tutoring at age fourth and second grade was working. The power of peers, not only to promote learning, but to promote a sense of self-efficacy. Let's use the peer group. Have you heard of Vygotsky's zones of proximal development, ZPDs? It's just a cool term, I just like saying it, that if you see someone just beyond, you know, that's why sometimes tutors can explain things better to students than some Joe, you know, PhD, LSD, PCP is so far removed from what it was. Here's someone just a little bit more advanced than them who can explain it in a way, and they can get it much better than someone who's beyond the zone of proximal development. I'd be in the zone of distal development, I guess. Personal meaning. Last formal definition. The rest I know you'll be able to intuit. Learning is more likely to take place when students find meaning or purpose in their college experience, when they perceive relevant connections between what they're learning in college, their current life, and their future goals. This slide was to show you that first-year students in general are at risk, and they need the challenge and support. But we need to make sure that that stretch, that challenge, doesn't become intimidating. And you know the research, I put this in for the first-year experience. All first-year students are at risk. They call it the retention funnel. It's widest at the beginning. If we can get them through the end of the sophomore year, up into upper division coursework, we are succeeding. But that risk, the challenge and support, often applies to all students who are moving from to so-called higher education. And as you know, many institutions are trying to wash their hands of this and passing it on to the community colleges to bridge that gap. Okay, sorry, here's Pasquarella and Terenzini on meaning. Research consistently shows that learning is bound neither by time nor by place, shows you the importance of learning outside the classroom, academic, advising, oh, you one-on-one people who I envy that one-on-one stuff you do in learning diagnostics. I was always hoping that I could get the Learning Center to come to our faculty development and show them the type of mistakes they were making when they, you know, it was just powerful one-on-one stuff you do outside of class. And that it is maximized when both the activities and outcomes have meaning to the learner. So if they know the purpose of it. Now, a recent book I read while I was trying not to clean out the garage was by Nash and Murray. Too often in the academy, we insist that our students pursue and achieve a whole host of academic and career purposes without first helping them to formulate systems of meaning to inform these purposes. You know, general ed requirements. Our students don't even know what liberal arts means. That's what I found. They think it has something to do with politics. No, I mean it. My first experience advising Laura Garcia, I'm sure you don't know Laura, so I can mention her name, 1983, she's a business major. And I said, well, you know, and I'm advising her, oh, you've got your micro and macroeconomics, you've got your pre-calc done, you've got accounting one and two, but Laura, there's, you know, we still have to work on some of your liberal arts requirements. Our school had a Catholic tradition, even though most of our students weren't Catholic. Philosophy, you know, you need a philosophy. I was doing like a grad check, degree audit thing with her. And she goes, why do I have to take philosophy? I'm a business major. And, you know, I'm a young faculty member. I never was taught how to advise or explain these things. I couldn't even articulate. I was a graduate of a liberal arts college in Brooklyn, New York, and couldn't tell you what liberal arts really meant. And this is what it's part of your well-rounded, what the heck I was saying, I don't know, education. And she pounded her fist on my desk. I said, it's part of your being a well-rounded liberal arts education. And she pounded her fist. I am not liberal. I voted for Reagan last election, and so did my parents. And I looked at her like she's pulling my leg. She was serious. I've been to some other colleges that have told me when I mentioned that story, people have come up afterward. And not only the students, but their parents don't have an idea of what all these liberal arts requirements, get them out of the way so they get into their real major. But gosh darn, we are the defenders of general education and liberal arts on our campus. It's the transferable, durable, lifelong learning skills. We are general education. We are the preservers of that. And is it not true that general education is more relevant for career preparation today than at any other time in the history of American higher education? You read the employer reports. What do they want? They want people who can think, who can write, who can communicate, who can problem solve, who can learn how to learn, who can find and from the library science professionals, who can learn if best thing if you don't know what it is to where to find it and to evaluate whether it's good information. That's what they want. Now, why am I saying this? These are things we need to intentionally articulate. I have written materials on this if you'd like this. It's something that you know, what is the meaning of liberal arts? What makes a humanity, a fine art? These are all things we never intentionally articulate to students. No wonder they devalue general education. Get it out of the way so I can get to my real major. And their parents are just as guilty. And some of them are college graduates. I'm sorry, this is a very emotional issue to me. Can we come up with a term other than basic skills? Basic sounds so elementary. It's more than that. It's foundational skills that everything is built on. Flexible, versatile, sustainable skills that students will use across subjects, across careers, throughout their life. I think we can articulate that better. Language matters. Comment for the developmental ed math people. Carnegie Pathways Project. Going on, trying to identify obstacles to students' progress in math. One of the major obstacles they discovered was doubts about the relevance of math, particularly algebra. I'm going to let that go. If time allowed, we could delve into that. Maybe it'll come up today. They don't see the point of it. And you hear the movement now in developmental ed. Let's stop with the prerequisites. Let's try to do co-requisites. Let's have them do the English that they need in conjunction with a content-based class, maybe an hour lab, rather than having to take a prereq before they can even apply it, so they can contextualize the knowledge immediately, see the relevance of it in a discipline, in a subject area. And you may have heard of the IBES movement in Washington. They're doing it, IBES, which I can't remember what the acronym stands for, but it's career technical education, where they're taking their developmental ed in conjunction and applying it to the technical courses they're learned. So moving from this prereq, do it, get out of the way, then take college level, to this co-req, the idea that they could take the skills they're learning and contextualize them in a meaningful situation. Okay. Number four is active involvement or engagement, correct? On your list, I'll move through this quickly. I noticed there was a session on rules of engagement this afternoon at 1. It's the hip term now. It has become sort of the centerpiece. Oops, slipped again. Do you ever have students like this? They're sitting in the back. It reminds me of Kirkwood that first year. They sit in the back of the class. It's like, Cuseo, what do you got? Why is this picture out of sequence now? Because I'm not a PowerPoint. The idea of motivation. How do we sell our courses? Particularly courses that don't seem to have direct connections to their career. We got to get them excited about general education. The Wabash, Wisconsin's doing studies of students during their freshman year. They come to college, their motivation declines over the first year. Something's happening that's killing the spirit. They think that college is going to be different than high school. And so this issue of motivation, I'm wondering if some of our developmental students, is it really a skill issue or is it a will issue? Or sometimes is it a strategy issue, you know? The idea of motivation and how to get students, that really was funnier if I used it in the proper context and didn't get too excited. But that actually was a birthday card sent to me by my brother when I turned 40, which is just a few decades ago. Okay. Engagement is the centerpiece. I'm happy to hear that there are sessions on it. It's, you know, you got the National Survey of Student Engagement. KU has been arguing for this. Aston calls it active involvement. Tinto calls it academic integration. But what I was arguing here in this slide is the things we've talked about on the bottom are really prerequisites for this. I want students to be engaged, but I found students will become more engaged if I validate them first. If they know that I know who they are, they're less threatened. They become more engaged. If we give them a sense of self-efficacy that their comments do matter, that their effort does matter, and they see the meaning or purpose of what we want them to engage about, then I think engagement occurs. That's why I covered those three first. We tend to jump right into engagement. I think there are preconditions, like the three that we talked about. And you know, a lot of this you talk about is starting in the classroom, that we use too much passive pedagogy. Even in developmental ed, if they've taken math and not succeeded to replicate the type of teaching they had in high school, again in math, is really going to disengage them. And here, it just happened to be a math slide. I have nothing against the math professors. I was trying to find an English or a psych slide. Here's a professor. I sense that a hand is raised, yet I cannot turn around. I like this slide because it's one criticism of us, not only developmental ed, but faculty in general. We're always covering content. We've got to get through those 18 chapters. We covered it, but whether students got it is another issue. So this idea of, I don't know if it'll come up today, or it could come up in our next session, how do we balance covering the material with getting students engaged? There's a trade-off here. Engagement does take time. We can cover a lot of material by talking at it, like I'm doing to you, which is cruel and unusual punishment. It's not my thing. You know, the research on brain-based learning, even highly motivated medical students and graduate students, this research occurred in England, where they had a tendency to focus more on the student rather than the lecturer. In America, our research is focusing on the great teacher. They were trying, and it was taboo in England to videotape the teacher. So they would be putting the cameras on the students while the teacher was teaching. Some of the best research on what students are doing when lecture is going on, you know, half the time they're not even if they're writing something down, they don't even know what they wrote down. And don't get me wrong, this is not a guilt trip. There's still a place for us as knowledgeable people to share our knowledge and to role model problems. So I'm not saying that. But after 10 to 15 minutes, even the highly motivated med students and grad students, the quality of their notes decreased, their retention of the material decreased. So the argument is now we need to augment, not replace or displace knowledgeable people sharing their knowledge, but augment it with periodic active learning things, maybe every 10 to 15 minutes. And your field, developmental ed, is perfect for that. You do it, have them do the problem. Do the writing, have them do a short write. Have them do a short read. It's a great field, a process field. First year experience is great for that too, where they can do an activity, a self-awareness exercise. Sometimes they call this the 10 to 2 lecture. Present for 10, let them do something for a couple of minutes. The idea of engagement. And that engagement also includes outside the classroom, as I said before. Students are not only disengaged in class, they're not using our support services. Despite tons of research indicating that students who use support services are more likely to be successful, it's unfortunate that those who need it the most are the least likely to use it. And males are at risk across the board. You've heard this research. Not just African-American males or Hispanic males. Males have poorer completion rates than females in general. Females are killing us. I mean, congratulations. But one of the reasons, the thought is, we don't use support services. Many campuses I go to, I talk to the peer leaders, and even there, it's incredible. I know there are more women in college than men, but when I talk to the peer leaders and mentors, it's like 90% to 10%. Women are not only getting involved in seeking help. I mean, is that why my dad never asked for directions when we got lost when we did our vacation? He was too proud? Is that the male thing? Is that it? But even in peer leadership and mentoring, women are taking the lead. My point here is all of those are looking at peer leaders and peer mentor programs. We really need to be conscious about actively recruiting males who don't seem to be volunteering as naturally as women. Look at the gender distribution in this room. Women are just more inclined to seek help and give help. I'm sorry, this is all not in the script, and I better get off it before I get in trouble. Reflection. I'll promise to be quick here, and I'm sorry, I'm a little off on time. It's great to be engaged, but they also need to reflect on what they're engaged about, right? That's the argument here. Do you remember this? I can't remember. You help me with this slide. What's this guy again? It's just the thinker, right? It's Rodin, right? I always like this slide. You know, can we give students time to think? We have to watch this in first year experience, by the way. We are accused of all these activities. Well, activities are good, but now time out. After the activity, let's have them reflect on that activity. I really like this brain-based research. It's showing there are two types of brain wave activities that are associated with deep learning. One are beta waves. You see the top one, high amplitude, low frequency. That's when they're engaged. And we got to get them engaged. That gets their attention. Using a computer metaphor, it's getting it on the screen. But then we want to get it from the screen into long-term memory. We want it to store. That's where reflection comes in. You've heard of alpha waves. Meditators tend to do this quite well. Different type of brain waves. It's two sides of a coin. If we get students engaged, gets their attention, that gets into working or short-term memory. Then if we get them to reflect, think about it, time out, slow it down, that moves it into long-term memory. Writing, I think this is the great argument for people who are in the writing professions, who are represented here. Writing is a great way to promote reflection. It slows down the thought process, right? And then they have a product of their thinking to see, does that make sense? To me, I like this whole idea of writing to learn. That's why I always said, give me the developmental students. I know they're still learning to write, but I can have them write to learn, if I'm making any sense. They still need to learn the mechanics of writing. But writing, even if they make some syntactical mistakes, I'll help them correct them. I want them to think about how they solve that problem. Some argue this can be used very effectively in math as well. You've heard of the one-minute paper? Give them a minute just to think about what you just covered. I use that to take attendance as well, by the way. It's a great way to take attendance without having to take roll. So at the end of class, they turn in their one-minute papers. And sometimes I'll use it to get them to activate their knowledge at the beginning of class. What do you think about this topic? Break up the class, and then maybe some quick question at the end. What's the takeaway today? What's most memorable? How could you apply what we just talked about? They turn it in. It doesn't take me that long to grade. If I have time, I usually write a little note. And it's a way of taking attendance. And when I give those papers back, you ever get that question when they miss class, Kathy? Did I miss anything important? Doesn't that drive you up the wall? No, we just had margaritas and mojitos and chips for an hour and a half. But when I'm giving these things back, you know, Ned, since I know you, and Ned sees he's not getting one back with some points on it and some personal comments, suddenly they think, well, I guess we did do something last time. Elie Wiesel, is that name right? Am I saying it right? Holocaust Nobel Prize winner. I like the way he says it. I write to understand as much as to be understood. I write to understand as much as to be understood. Writing and reflection are a great combo. Social integration. A few cartoons here and I'll get you going. We need students to connect with other students and with us. That matters. That's Tinto's idea. Remember Maslow's need hierarchy? If I got it in one more psych class, I think I was going to go nuts. But it's very relevant. Love and belonging matter. Then we can self-actualization is built on it. They feel they belong. They feel they're part of a community. And you know, this is so powerful. It's not only making them feel comfortable. You know, you've heard of the notion that knowledge is socially constructed. When peers talk to peers about what they're learning, it really magnifies the learning. It builds on each other. And it's so powerful, it's showing research that peers, helping peers, not only improves knowledge, but critical thinking and creative thinking. Now, give me a chance on this slide. I know you're not going to think it's true. You know how rats run mazes for food, and they typically have them run individually? Well, this experiment, they allowed rats to collaborate prior to running the maze, and the result was a creative insight into how that... Now you're laughing like that could not possibly happen. The rats don't have the frontal lobe that we do. But keep in mind that these were gifted Italian rats of my ethnic background. They were raised by yours truly with multiple degrees, some academic, some psychedelic. And this all happened in New York City, the environmental stimulation capital of the world. So they had that enriched learning environment. Peers, helping peers, the research is unassailable. Learning communities, I don't know if you've experimented with much here. Research at Kingsborough Community College has been very powerful, where they take students, developmental ed, first year experience course, and a general ed course. They travel as a cohort together. They apply their experiences in the first year experience course and the developmental ed course to their content-based general ed course. They're reporting lots of good results on this. We talked about self-efficacy before. There's a new term I'm seeing emerging in the literature, collective efficacy. We can do it together. Helping students use other students as social resources. So I'm happy to hear the peer involvement today. Very important application of this. Quick one here, student-faculty contact outside the classroom. I'm stunned when I read that in the late 80s. I always thought what mattered most is what I did in class. But those little meetings they have with you at lunch, in your office, that's powerful stuff. So that's social integration. We can send clues or cues in the classroom, but that out-of-class contact, I wish community college administrators would be more aware of that. Your teaching loads are very high. We give reassigned time like crazy at research universities. I wish we would be more intentional about faculty who want to make a commitment to student clubs and organizations and out-of-class and field work, that kind of stuff, very powerful. I don't know if you can get administrative support. It's hard when you have five preps or five courses per year. It's the misinterpretation that work is only done in the classroom. And lastly, self-awareness, and I'm sorry I went over a little bit, guys. I don't know if they're advisors here, but I learned as an advisor, our students, they pick majors based on, like, we have so many forensics majors in California. It's all that, tell me with that program again. CSI, I mean, it's so unrealistic. They're not looking at themselves first. You know, I've learned early on as an advisor, first step is know thy, well, it's the classic platonic thing, know thyself. Start with that. Then know your talents. That's what I think we're great at. This whole idea of multiple intelligence. You may not be good, you may be struggling a little bit in English or math, but part of the success is the struggle. That's the self-efficacy. Let's find your talent, your values, your needs, your interests, your strengths. That's the first step to good advising in anything. And I think our field does a better job than content-based fields of encouraging students to self-monitor. Are they really getting it? Have you learned that deeply? You know how the students can fool themselves, like they've just memorized it, but they can't apply it to a new math problem or can't transfer it. How do I know that I really know it? Or what am I doing differently this time to make me successful that I didn't do before? These are the questions that we ask. I submit to you, this is not happening anywhere else in the curriculum. And I would end with this. We do rigor. Metacognition. Metacognitive math is on that list of things. We are doing are we not doing critical thinking? We're asking them to evaluate their reading, evaluate the quality of their own writing. I think we're doing rigorous, higher-level thinking. We're having them analyze. We're having them synthesize. If we use Bloom's taxonomy, we have them apply. These are HOTS, higher-order thinking skills. See, you know, if you use higher-order thinking skills, you're a hottie. And if you use high-impact practices, you're a hippie. So you can be a hot hippie or a hip hottie, I guess, if you want to call it that. But rigor, this idea of rigor, I think it's in one of the sessions, we always get accused about that. What is rigor? I had a history professor giving me flack about my first year experience because whether it should be receiving college credit. This dude, pardon me, he's a friend of mine, Anthony, gives a midterm and a final in history. I looked at his, it's fact-based. Very little writing, very little higher than knowledge. And here I am, my first year experience course. They're doing 1-minute papers with critical thinking prompts. How would you apply this? How would you connect this with something? This is all the higher level stuff, the writing, the intense stuff we're doing. And he's giving me poop about whether my course is not rigorous enough. God darn it, nobody does things as rigorously as we do. We're doing deep strategic learning, not just remedial education. Thanks for hanging with me this whole time. I appreciate it. I look forward to hanging out with you the rest of the day. And I'm sorry if I made our time a little bit off, Gina. Thanks for your attention. I look forward to seeing you again.